The Unshackled Waves, Episode 3. Hello and welcome to the Unshackled Waves podcast. I'm Tim Wilms and this is our first ever philosophy show, part of the expansion of the podcast. We aim to be able to produce one of these every week. Now the way it will work is that we'll focus on a single issue for the duration of the show. Often we'll have different points of view with the aim to unpack the issue and explore all the different aspects of it. News comes and goes every week, so with this show we aim to offer a more timeless analysis. My co-host for this week is Unshackled contributor Sam Oldfield. Welcome back to the show.
Thanks for having me, Tim.
Now, the first issue we are going to explore is libertarianism, because Sam and I have had a long association with the libertarian movement in Australia, and we've both become quite saddened by the movement's direction over the past year. How it is apparently taking the side of the cultural left and becoming slowly detached and irrelevant from mainstream society. Now, I know that other libertarians will listen to this and want to revoke our libertarian cards, but please just listen, consider what we have to say, and have a mature response.
Yeah, I've got to say, I kind of tore up my own libertarian card, so that's not a big issue to me.
I've still got mine, so... But we will start by first defining what is libertarianism and then exploring its history before moving on to some of the more contemporary issues. So first, what is libertarianism?
It's a big question. It's kind of hard to discuss an idea without first talking about its history. But in general, it's this idea of an agreement between the economic right and the socially liberal left about sort of general principles by which government should be run. In general, less is more.
Yeah, it's often sold to the public as economically conservative and socially liberal. That's how they try to sell it to the normal person. Obviously, the principles that they discuss is free markets, individual liberty, private property, and civil society. And they also like to talk about the non-aggression principle and also press upon the importance of voluntary association.
Sure, yep.
So that's basically the basic concepts. Now we'll move into the history of libertarianism, or as it was called in the beginning, classical liberalism. So where do you believe that it all starts?
Well, when discussing the history of ideas, it's hard to know exactly where to start. Really, I mean, we can go all the way back to Rome and early Christendom. We can walk through the Protestant Reformation, the Holy Roman Empire, leading up to the Treaty of Westphalia, but a lot of that's probably unnecessary. The best place to start is 1776, which saw two momentous events, the Declaration of Independence in America and the publishing of The Wealth of Nations by Adam Smith. Both of those things are necessary to understand the Industrial Revolution through classical economics, sometimes called classical liberalism, and libertarianism is the heir apparent to classical liberalism. In a nutshell, Americans all but invented a new form of government in the form of a democratic republic. It was built around the idea that natural rights are the highest authority and that people should be more or less free to govern themselves within the bounds of natural law. Adam Smith developed those ideas in a more cogent understanding of how a free market economy should work. He famously noted that society works best when each member of it acts according to their own self-interest. This was revolutionary at the time. Up until that point, it had all but been assumed that society was most prosperous when, on the whole, it had the most power and the most money compared to other powers. Trade at the time was a diplomatic tool in the conquest of greater wealth and power for the state, a power play, if you like, through which the more powerful side got rich at the expense of the less powerful side. Adam Smith realized, in fact, that trade makes both parties better off. Otherwise, people would not trade, regardless of laws. He noticed that even though the French were the enemies of the English, rivaling them in power, that the trade of English ale for French wine meant more of both for both countries.
Yeah, Adam Smith definitely, he crystallized that by acting in our self-interest, we're actually helping each other. So he was basically saying that, you know, as long as you're looking after yourself and trading with someone voluntary, that's what's making society go forward. And yeah, obviously, destroying the doctrine of mercantilism was another big achievement of his, showing how trade did benefit both parties. It's interesting that today we're still having that debate. Yeah, and the American Revolution was definitely focusing on what they termed in Thomas Jefferson said in the Declaration of Independence, inalienable rights, that we are born with these as humans, or if you're religious, they come from God and they can't be taken away.
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll move forward to, so that was in the late 18th century, both the Wealth of Nations and American Revolution, they around about happened at the same time. Then in the mid 19th century, around the 1850s, is where we saw classical liberalism really come into its stride in Europe.
Yeah, and that's mostly to do with the Austrian school. And so the origins of the Austrian school are basically the Austrian and the German schools of economics grew out of competing understandings of economics in Central Europe. The Austrians argued that theory was at least as important as historical measurements, where the German school argued only what was measured mattered. Pure theory was irrelevant. We skipped the discussion of the Holy Roman Empire earlier, but what does need to be understood is that the Austrians and the Prussians had regularly gone to war over who had the right to rule all of Europe. The Prussians at this point were winning. If the Austrian school had a founder, it's Karl Menger, whose 1871 book, The Principles of Economics, was the first treatise to apply calculus to economic logic to create a theory of marginal utility. This was followed by von Bormann's numerous attacks on Hegel and the German school, specifically the constitutions of Karl Marx. The Austrian school rests in large part on the idea that once property rights are clearly defined, regardless of how property is allocated, that market forces will automatically kick in to allocate resources to their highest use. There was no need for law or regulation because market forces just knew better. Later criticisms pointed out that the Austrian school just so happened to justify the maintenance of the huge fortunes of the Austrian nobility, of which almost all the members of the Austrian school were a part.
Going back to just explaining what the Austrian school contribution is, for those of you who don't know, its main initial discovery was that we value is subjective, that we value, for example, like I value this microphone not because somebody went to a lot of effort to build it, but because it's very valuable to me. And that was opposed to Adam Smith and the other classical economists who actually propagated an early version of Karl Marx's labor theory of value.
Well, in actual fact, that Karl Marx didn't do too much with the labor theory of value. Marx was more concerned with surplus value rather than the labor theory of value. But the labor theory of value was, in fact, pure Smith. And he was just pointing out that if you can't sell something for more than what it costs to produce it, then you won't produce it.
Yeah. Now, we've talked a lot about theory so far, but let's talk about the implementation of classical liberalism in the 19th century in Europe.
Well, the question there is how those ideas sort of spread. While the Austrians were treating economics as just a theoretical exercise, the English and the French were testing it out. The Industrial Revolution, which had begun in England and spread to Europe, was in full swing during the 19th century. And although the economies of Britain and France were very much laissez-faire, the point to it was still the power of the state. Both nations still used the enormous productive powers of capitalism to fund armies and fleets to make a very good effort at conquering the world. The French Revolution and the Napoleonic Wars had taught both countries very valuable lessons in making sure that there was something in it for their citizens. As such, things like the abolition of slavery, bankruptcy laws, joint stock company, and many other things that which are the foundation of 21st century capitalism, were invented to ensure that people were getting their rightful cut of the pie. As a result, people became quite loyal to their empires, particularly in England, where the crown was still tremendously powerful, and the nobility was firmly entrenched as a class. But even the common man truly felt that he was not only part of something greater, but that it was his as much as anyone else's. During that time, socialism was taking root amongst various union movements, but neither socialism nor unionism were anything like what we came to know them as in the 20th century. Marx spent his later life in England, but at that point, it was still a relative nobody. One voice amongst many, all declaring socialism to be different things. In fact, the most powerful voice was the Fabian Society, who were instrumental in developing what we know today as the corporation, but they had absolutely no time for Marx's revolutionary rhetoric. The empires were both largely built on trade between the imperial centre and the colonies, raw material for finished goods. As a result, both the imperial heart and the colonies thrived, and the need for ever more land was a huge factor in this. A shepherd in 16th century England was a peasant and a pauper. By the late 19th century, a shepherd in Australia was as rich as royalty.
Yeah, there was a bit. It's also worth noting there was a big the reason for this big change in the Industrial Revolution is economist and historian Deirdre McCloskey. She talks about how the entrepreneur began to be more valued in Western society, and that was a big contribution. But it's also because capitalism, it's about mass production for the masses. That means production was geared towards what the ordinary people wanted, and also the fact that there was the class system or the feudal system was beginning to collapse, and then an ordinary person could rise to the top much more easily, which introduced social mobility.
Yeah. So that's the point, that it's no longer the power of the state, but rather the state now works for the people rather than the other way around.
Yeah, it was quite a monumental shift in the way that, not just Western society, but global society had been run for many centuries.
Yeah, but of course it didn't last. And that alone is a huge subject. It would take too long to deal with the cause and consequences of World War One in this podcast. I advise people to listen to Dan Carlin's Hardcore History. Tells the story in exquisite detail. It's up on iTunes for free. It's also up on YouTube, if that's easier. But the Cliff Notes version is basically this. The causes of World War One were largely due to a breakdown in a very complicated diplomatic framework set up by German Chancellor Otto von Bismarck. It's so complicated that Bismarck himself was the only one who knew how to manage it. And with his death in 1898, the whole thing quickly turned into a time bomb. In 1913, the entire continent found itself at war without really knowing why. But what they did know was that the only way to stop it was to win it. At the outset of the war, it was assumed that if Germany could hold off the British and French for 6 months, that the British would run out of money and surrender. And you've got to keep in mind that in the 19th century, it had been largely peaceful. And so the only real theory of war between major powers was still mostly based around a discussion of Napoleon. But of course, in that time, the Industrial Revolution and capitalism happened. And the tremendous productive forces of capitalism came to bear on the subject of war. It became clear, certainly to the Germans, that the only way to end the war was to kill so many of the opposing side that they would simply give up. The war was so expensive, so destructive, that by the end of it, thoroughly exhausted and in debt up to their eyeballs, mostly to Americans who had a booming economy as a result, all sides decided to disarm to avoid such a catastrophic nightmare from ever happening again. It's also worth noting the role that Marxism played in ending the war. First, of course, with the Bolshevik Revolution in Russia, deliberately spread and encouraged by German infiltrators, and then the collapsing of Germany's own morale as it spread back to German lines on the Western Front.
It was sort of the end of the golden era of laissez-faire and classical liberalism with the coming of World War One, because then we saw the rise of nationalism and what is the actual definition of the word fascism, which is the state working with industry. And so because the end of World War One, it messed up Europe's economy, and even though the United States benefited from the end of World War One, because they were getting all this business from rebuilding Europe, when that ended, that was one of the catalysts for the Great Depression. And sadly, these economic hardships, that's what led to the rise of bad economics.
Well, yeah, I mean, so this is about the time of Keynes, and Keynes was mostly remembered for his general theory of employment, interest, and money. But what made him famous was his earlier book, The Economic Consequences of the Peace. What he observed was that the sudden changes to the economy, both in England and in Germany, as well as the move towards more protectionist trade policies, would not only make everyone poor, but would inevitably lead to another war. The effort to punish Germany for the war had saddled Germans with a debt they couldn't possibly pay, while at the same time destroying the largest customer of English industry. So what Keynes proposed, and this has been horribly abused by the left, is that England borrow more money to rearm, thus providing employment to its people, which would provide tax revenue to the state, which would in turn allow the state to pay off the debt. He wasn't heeded at the time, but the Great Depression was just around the corner. The stock market crash of 1929 was in no small part due to the realization that Europe would be unable to service its debt to American banks. This destroyed the last remnants of British industry, and Germany by that time was on full strike. At which point fascism did begin to rear its ugly head. The rejection of both capitalism and communism was returned to the idea that the more powerful the state, the more powerful the people of the state. Keynes became very popular outside of Britain. The rise of Hitler, which had seen the exile of the largely Jewish Austrian school to Britain, was initially treated as an economic miracle. By the end of the war, by the end of World War II, Hayek was writing his famous book, The Road to Serfdom, in opposition to these ideas. It's Hayek's assertion that socialism, however practiced, leads inevitably to a totalitarian state. This, more than any other book, even arguably The Wealth of Nations itself, forms the foundation of libertarianism today.
It's also important to note that the reason why Keynes was so popular during this time was the fact that he told governments what they wanted to hear, justified their role in managing the economy.
I'm not so sure if it's so much that he told governments what they wanted to hear. It's just that it certainly became an excuse for certain government actions within the economy.
So it was certainly, I know that the free market economists were definitely in a dark place during this time. But after World War II, that's when the Cold War began, and when people believed there was a sharp distinction between the Soviet Union, the communist world, and the free world, the capitalist world led by America.
The Soviet Union was certainly the premier example of socialism. To argue that it isn't is simply intellectually dishonest. And it largely did follow Hayek's predictions of it. But at the time, Hayek was a pretty minor voice. People, certainly in America, were more interested in fellow Austrian Joseph Schumpeter, whose theories of creative destruction gave the most complete explanation for the Great Depression. It's also a lot less critical of government. Schumpeter was also a lot less critical of government than his Austrian colleagues. He'd found some truth to Keynes's idea of government control of the commanding heights of capitalism, particularly as it related to finance, though still advocating the greater bulk of the economy should be a system of free enterprise. And of course, America, as one of the two major powers left standing at the end of World War II, had a problem. The other major power was the Soviet Union, who were happily spreading Marxist communism to wherever they could. Americans were exceedingly rich by world standards, so the idea of spreading the wealth to fiercely individualist Americans who didn't much like their own government, let alone anyone else's, was naturally pretty horrifying. The Cold War began in earnest with the Soviet blockade of West Berlin, and this meant Americans had a problem. They have to stick up for capitalism, but at the same time keep the Soviets contained. And by the time the Soviets got the bomb, that was a really big problem.
And it's also worth, because During this time, there were, even though we didn't know the full disaster of what was happening in the communist worlds with the famines and the killings, there were signs that there were cracks in the communist system. I mean, you just had to look at the people who wanted to escape from East Berlin into the West, and also the crushed uprisings first in East Germany in 53, Hungary in 1956, and Czechoslovakia in 1968.
Is when you look at, and you sort of got to go back to why America won the Cold War there, and in theory it's because free enterprise is the better system. Socialism inevitably collapses because there are no incentives to keep going. And I disagree with you, is in the 60s, the Soviet Union was an existential threat to liberalism in the world. There was very little indication that the Soviet Union was showing cracks, as it were. The indication was, holy crap, these guys are going to beat us. But by the 80s, it was definitely starving and hopelessly bankrupt. That wasn't just because free enterprise was a better system. It was also because the Cold War was tremendously expensive to both sides. Free enterprise meant that Americans were able to afford it, where the Soviet Union was not. But it was the US government that really won the war. Because of the productive powers of capitalism, the US government was able to amass a lot more military materiel than the Soviet Union, and the Soviet Union simply went bankrupt trying to keep up. And throughout all of this was a propaganda war. In Western Europe, America sponsored various radio stations under the organizational heading Radio Free Europe, which were responsible in a lot of ways for the revolutions you were talking about. And Radio Free Europe used a lot of libertarian theory to criticize the Soviet Union and foment dissent and rebellion in the Eastern Bloc. And successfully. But guys like Tom Palmer, Lou Rockwell, Thomas Woods, and other prominent libertarians today, they were all part of that circle of Radio Free Europe and RAND Corporation, which was the largest free market think tank in America. So naturally, these guys were pretty zealous. And by the end of the Cold War, they're left in an America that is ostensibly the champion of the free market, but yet has this huge military industrial complex and this burdensome regulatory state and high taxes to pay for a war that never happened and wasn't going to. And America faced the same problem after the Cold War that Britain had after World War I. A sudden demilitarization would lead to a possible depression. So the military spending had to continue. America had essentially become addicted to it. And so while libertarian theory at this point was pretty complete, it was internally consistent and it matched the real world quite well, America wasn't libertarian by any stretch. And so the libertarian movement sort of grows out of this tension between the desire for the most free market an economy can be and the need to pay for it to defend it from enemies that did not, at the time, exist.
There was a lot of conservatives who, at the time of the Cold War build-up, said that this is just temporary until we can defeat the Soviet Union. And when the Soviet Union collapsed in 1991, that's when there was the split between the neoconservatives, who wanted to keep the military-industrial complex going and look for new enemies, and then there was the paleoconservatives, which Pat Buchanan was probably the highest profile person at the time, who said, okay, we've won the Cold War, now let's just retreat, just look after ourselves and have America first.
Yes, sure.
And of course, it looked like, although Pat Buchanan did well in 1992 and 1996, it was pretty much since the end of the Cold War, it was the neoconservatives who pretty much ran the show. And even under Bill Clinton, of course, and then turbocharged by George W. Bush during his years. And libertarianism didn't really have a resurgence until Ron Paul came along.
Yeah, so Ron Paul was elected in 1997 as a Republican, advocating for very small government and strict adherence to the Constitution. But between the fall of the Soviet Union and the 2000 campaign, the libertarian right were very much not in charge of the Republican Party. The Republicans were still using libertarian rhetoric surrounding freedom and capitalism, but were very much in the hands of the neoconservatives, coming from a think tank called the Project for a New American Century. The Project for a New American Century was set up under Bush Sr., using a lot of people in the Reagan administration. It held broadly free market principles, but it held that since America had won the Cold War, it was up to America to clear the last vestiges of socialism from the earth. Despite being nominally Republican, they were very influential, as you said, during the Clinton administration, with a couple of favorite targets, most notably Saddam Hussein's Iraq, who'd sided with the Soviets on a lot of issues. The neocons had promoted Islam as a weapon to counter socialism and Soviet influence, particularly in countries like Iraq and Afghanistan. And on September 11th, 2001, the plan failed spectacularly. Bush Jr., a firm neocon, reacted as a neocon, which is to say he declared war on everyone not declaring war on whoever he was declaring war on, famously saying, "You're either with us or against us." By 2001, the neocons were all but destroyed by their failure to anticipate Islamic blowback to American imperialism. The project for a new American century was shut down, and Republicans like John McCain were desperately trying to distance themselves from the Bush administration without shifting to the left. And Ron Paul's 2008 campaign offered the libertarian viewpoint as a replacement vision for conservatism for the Republican Party.
Yeah, he ran for president under the Republicans in 2008 and 2012. He'd also run under the Libertarian ticket back in 1988. So he had been around since he was elected to Congress in 1997. But it's also worth looking on, because it's basically termed Ron Paul's revolution. It's worth looking at why was it successful.
Well, Ron Paul was successful in no small part due to the remnants of the Cold War rhetoric in the public discussion. The neocons had all been all about talking up freedom and capitalism, just not so great at practicing it. And he had a great intellectual base to draw from in the form of former Cold War warriors who, having won the Cold War, were wondering why we hadn't blown the entire military budget on champagne. And with the growing disaster in Iraq and fierce opposition to the war on the left, his message found a receptive audience. A lot of conservatives, looking at their tax bills and tired of talking about race and sexuality, were prepared to give ground on all the social stuff in return for a more reasonable economic policy. The 2007 financial crisis made this a key issue. Libertarians proffered the theory that not only was government not the solution to the problem, the government was in fact the cause. And they point to economists like Paul Krugman, who had advocated for an increased government spending after the NASDAQ bubble in 1999, as evidence that all the government can do is blow a bigger bubble. And what needs to happen is for the government to stop spending to allow the malinvestment to clear, which was Schumpeter's point way back in the Depression. So Ron Paul's reasonable arguments captured the imagination of a lot of, shall we say, energetic thinkers. The campaign captured the surprising number of people who did not trust banks, believed the government was corrupt, and that the Federal Reserve was a conspiracy. Ron Paul's belief that a gold-backed currency, which would be beyond government control, was a better form of currency, had the simultaneous effect of creating a rabid base and repelling anyone not of that mindset or able to get past it. I remember at the time I was quite angry about the GFC, and not having a firm grasp of economics myself, I bought into the sound money arguments in a big way. I've still got a couple of grand of silver stashed away somewhere. It wasn't until I tried to sell it that I began to take a more holistic approach to economics. The other advantage of the Ron Paul campaign and the broader libertarian movement is that so much of American symbolism has to do with freedom. The flag, the eagle, the silver dollar, they're all designed to inspire patriotic fervor, but they also inspired an almost religious affection for the libertarian ideas, in no small part thanks to the neocons.
It's also worth the reason why I believe that Ron Paul is so successful is because he provided solutions to the current problems that were facing the world. I mean, with the financial crisis, he'd been talking about the Federal Reserve, gold and silver, government regulation for years. He was seen as the person who had the solutions to that problem. And it was also the fact that Americans by that time, after the two Middle Eastern wars, were growing war weary. People wanted to retreat again. There was also the drug war was getting quite authoritarian in America. People were growing tired from that. And also because he was able to bring together a grand coalition. He was able to bring together left liberals who saw the Democrats and Obama as weak on their important issues. He was able to bring cross religious conservatives because he had a good message on religious liberty and also the Patriot movement as well.
Yeah, I think most of that's fairly reasonable.
So I have You have been quite critical of the libertarian movement, but what do you make of this period?
Well, I'd say I'm more cynical than critical. Don't get me wrong, Adam Smith and Friedrich Hayek were far more right than they are wrong. A system of free enterprise is without a doubt the best way to manage an economy. Plus, I don't particularly like being told what to do by politicians. And you only have to start a business or even chop down a tree in this country to realize that we're overregulated. The problem is that the libertarian movement became utopian and overzealous. It sells very well to young people and conspiracy quacks, but by the time you have to start selling it to the silent majority, the young people and the conspiracy quacks have taken control and started being generally unpleasant to anyone not as zealous as themselves.
So there was obviously the Ron Paul presidential campaigns of 2008, 2012, which got people really energized, and there's all this talk about, the libertarian moment, and people thought that the libertarian movement would just continue to grow and eventually we'd get a libertarian president in 4 or 8 years' time. But then it began to fall apart. The Grand Coalition failed to materialize. Now, the left are viewed, as we talked about, as generally anti-war, and so there was this big try and outreach to the left and Democrats, but that, as we have seen, has pretty much failed. While appealing to obviously conservatives and Republicans has been much more successful. So, why do you think this has been the case?
Well, I think, again, this has got a lot to do with the Cold War. With the collapse of the Soviet Union, the right was without an enemy to justify its existence. And that was because the left at this point had no real existence at all, except to nod obediently along to whatever the right was saying. And into this vacuum sort of stepped their own alternative visions for the left. And specifically, that was environmentalism and gender theory. And I mean, Al Gore's Inconvenient Truth was released in 2007. Massachusetts became the first state in the US to recognize gay marriage in 2004. And this was all about right about the time that Hillary Clinton started evolving on these issues. But it also coincided with Ron Paul's campaign. And the beauty of both of these was that the enemy was the same, the decadent capitalist West. But the rhetoric was all new. And you only have to study feminism and gender politics for a while to realize that what you're reading is Marxism. They've changed the words and who the classes are, but the framework of the theory is still largely the same. Capitalism is replaced by patriarchy, the proletariat is replaced by women and gays, the panopticon is replaced by internalized misogyny and homophobia. Environmentalism, on the other hand, is built almost entirely around the idea that wealth is destructive, and so business conducted at a profit is immoral. Climate change managed to almost completely snuff out any discussion of other environmental concerns, not because climate change is much of a concern, but because those deemed responsible for climate change were much wealthier than those deemed responsible for deforestation, for example.
It's also worth noting that from 2012 onwards, that's when we saw the left become much more totalitarian. I mean, this was when we saw the rise of social justice warriors and identity politics, where, yeah, as you mentioned, that basically they'd replaced class oppression with all these minorities are being oppressed. And it's also when we saw political correctness rear its ugly head again, and then suppression of free speech, not just on university campuses, but people, losing their jobs or having their businesses shut down because they disagreed with their politically correct class as well.
And so that's most of that comes under the heading of gender theory, and it's this, and as I said, it's still basically Marxism. It's just still dealing with haves versus have-nots. Only now it's straight white males are the haves because they have patriarchy, and everybody else is the have-not, don't. And patriarchy is one of those words that's just so, foggily defined that it applies to anything. And if you sort of dig through the more intellectual side of their arguments, is you quickly realize, oh, hang on a second, this is really, it is just a synonym for capitalism.
Yeah, and it's also worth noting as well that libertarians they picked the wrong side of of this battle to be on. I mean, they tried to, we should try and understand these people because they mean well, but no, they're not interested in liberty and freedom. They're interested about overthrowing what they perceive as the oppressive society and really about destructiveness.
Yeah.
But it's also worth noting as well, I mean, obviously, this social justice and political correctness stuff is sort of what we're seeing most from the left these days, but the reason why they've never bought into the idea of libertarianism is because they still hold to this idea that government is able to fix all of our problems, and if there's something wrong in the world, a law can be passed to fix it. And also the fact that they view free markets and capitalism as, giving corporations more power to rule over us. And so that's why they never buy the free market side of things.
Well, I mean, there are left libertarians, and, they advocate for open borders and social reforms. And sort of to understand that strain of thought, you need to understand a gentleman by the name of Samuel Conklin III, one of the original hacktivists and one of the probably the most influential anarchists of the late 20th century. What Conklin recognized was that it didn't matter whether a system was capitalist or socialist, the same people and the same organizations would be in charge. In Western capitalism, there were corporations run by executives. In Eastern communism, they were bureaus run by secretaries. Either way, you were being ruled, and no number of revolutions would change that. And so Konkin labelled the executives and bureaucrats the political class, which is now a term in common use. And it must be understood that left libertarians are a very different species to mainstream or right libertarians. Left libertarianism was Marxism, but after the fall of the Soviet Union, its members were former Marxists who had admitted that Marxism was indeed a failure and there was no point resurrecting or rebadging it. Konkin advocated for a new system called agorism. These days it's called anarcho-capitalism, which was fundamentally free market in nature, but built on a Marxist understanding of power structures. The general gist of the idea was that people should decide for themselves to turn away from the state and its artifices, and that an anarchist society will naturally form from the efficiency of market forces. Now, this is in contrast to the broader left view that you don't have a choice to get a job. Essentially, it's either you're under threat, is because if you don't have a job in a free market society, you'll starve. And so that's not a choice, that's a threat. And so they sort of see the welfare state as the way to solve those problems. And that this is sort of harking back to Fabian socialism slow and incremental drive towards socialism, but for the agorists people will naturally choose anarchy because selling legal goods illegally avoids tax. So it stands to reason that if given the choice, people will naturally opt for the cheaper illegal goods rather than the more expensive legal goods. And without admitting to any crimes, I'll say there's some truth to it. But at the same time, it's still necessarily reliant on government to enforce the good order of society so that trade can take place. It appeals to survivalists and those who think they can look after themselves, but as well as those accustomed to buying illegal goods like drugs. But for the average Joe, regular old capitalism is just easier.
Yeah, definitely anarcho-capitalists. They definitely share the sort of revolutionary aspects of Marxism, that they view the state as the ultimate oppressor. It pervades every aspect of our lives, screwing us over in every aspect. And so they really don't view participation with the political process very well.
No, they don't. And you can see pretty easily how that's a recipe for political failure so the anarchists, they don't want government at all. They're not affiliated to any political party. And while I don't want to speak in broad terms about they and them, we're just sort of attacking the underlying theory here. But all politicians are inherently corrupt and all institutions of the state are inherently violent. What politicians want is to get elected, and what party apparatchiks want is for them to get elected in return for some dividend of their own. And so the left libertarian argument is that it's impossible to get liberty from the government. It's a fairly sound argument if you define liberty as the absolute freedom from restriction whatsoever. But the inherent contradiction of that is that, well, how do you turn that into a political movement without, you know, voting and political participation? And so, you know, if they're all not voting, well, then they all don't count. It doesn't matter what they believe. They're pointless. They're just sitting there talking amongst themselves. But if you take the more conservative approach to liberty, that's the freedom to succeed or fail in the enterprise of your choosing without interference from bureaucrats, then you'll probably see left libertarianism as advocating for law of the jungle.
They tend to believe, a lot of these anarcho-capitalists and left libertarians, that they live in their own world, and if they just wish the state away, it will just magically disappear. That's the impression I seem to get from them.
Yeah, and you know, it doesn't matter how many times I pointed out to them that, you know, you can't vote for anarchy, that it never seems to sink in. They seem to see anarchy as possible and not just this sort of as it was intended by the original Austrians, you know, as a theoretical tool to understand the state. They sort of see it as this desirable end goal. Which is silly, is the minute we ever actually had a truly anarchic society, the first thing people would do was band together and form a government. At some point there, you're going to need to make rules about, you know, exactly what the government isn't allowed to do. And if you're making the rules a lot more strict than they are today about things that the government isn't allowed to do, which is possibly a good idea, but you've still got a government there. You've still got a state. It's just a more liberal state.
Now, probably the issue that's divided libertarians the most in recent years is open borders. Now, the left advocate for open borders, which we're seeing the consequences of that at the moment, but they still say that they have these open borders talking points where they just say, oh, it's good for all of these reasons and you just all need to recognize them.
Well, I mean, the left libertarians, certainly they see immigration controls as a restriction of movement across invisible lines, denying the absolute liberty that they're after. And there are some economic arguments as well, but they're generally not borne out by evidence. And even when they do manage to find cases of economic growth from unrestricted immigration, then it's not exactly because of the examples aren't exactly beacons of freedom and happiness. The economic arguments are also kind of deceitful because they're talking about importing labor or workers and not people with their own ideas about how society should be run. And this sort of leads to the most spectacular failure of libertarian theory, which is to recognize and react to the threat of Islam. Islam is a competing political ideology with a complete set of laws and rules for how government should operate. And it's not libertarian by any stretch of the imagination. I mean, neo-Nazis in the West, looking at Saudi Arabia, thinking, yeah, that's probably a bit much. You don't need to be that fascist. You can at least let the women drive. And Saudi Arabia, of course, is the best example Muslims have of a functional Islamic society. And so, so functional, in fact, that they don't have open borders, even for other Muslims, lest it become dysfunctional.
Saudi Arabia and the other Gulf states, they won't accept any refugees because of security reasons, but suddenly it's all our responsibility. We'll talk about, obviously, the left libertarians, their failure to see Islam as a threat. And it's obviously because they want to be seen as compassionate and caring, and obviously this is part of their outreach to the left, and they have this idea that, oh, you know, we just all need to love each other and it'll all be good, which is not the reality at all. I mean, we're seeing obviously the drain on the welfare state that open borders has, the threats to the minorities, which the left supposedly cares about, not to mention a lot of the crime and property damage that comes with it. And if you view Islam as just an ideology, as communism, then you can then you don't think of it as this religious liberty issue, you think of it as a ideology, then you can look at things much more rationally.
Sure, but the mistake of the left and the left libertarian outreach to the left there is you haven't quite understood what the left's goal there is, and it's by libertarian theory that you should be able to understand it, is that they're trying to get elected. That's what they want here. And so they're, you know, proposing these rhetorical strikes for, you know, against racism and things like this. This is a power play for them, is the idea that, you know, if we agree to this, that they'll suddenly vote for us. Well, that's not going to happen, is they'll just switch to something else, and they largely have. So there's the idea that you can that there's some olive branch that we can extend there is nonsense. That's not what's going on. It's not the reality of the situation. As for you know, the libertarian sort of failure to see the threat of Islam, I think the first point there is, I think a lot of people confuse politeness from Muslims with agreement. And I've got a pretty cool story there I got from a German guy who from Hamburg. So he actually lived just down the road from, I forget the name of the guy who planned the 9/11 attack. So that was called the Hamburg Cell. They all, you know, studied in Hamburg. And yeah, he's living just down the road from the terrorists. Never had any problems with him, right? Got along famously. In fact, when the Interpol actually called up to interview the terrorist's former employer, the terrorist's former employer thought he was being called for a reference and gave a glowing one. He said that he was great. He didn't bother anybody with his religious stuff. You know, he prayed five times a day, but it never bothered anyone. And other than that, he got along well with all his other co-workers and all this sort of stuff. It's like, yeah, is you know, you can't just pointing out that your enemy's polite doesn't make them not your enemies. Is, you know, you don't have to dehumanize someone to fight them, is I certainly see Muslims as human and as a result, you know, capable of common decency. That doesn't mean that we can tolerate their presence. And I think the deeper point is that the American brand of religious liberty, which has evolved from the Constitution, which was basically set up to ensure there was never going to be a Church of America, has evolved into this believe whatever you want as long as it doesn't hurt anybody else. And that works really well when you're talking about Protestant Christianity, which is something that takes place on Sunday mornings before everybody gets on with their lives. And the teachings of most Protestant churches are, for the most part, consistent with the right libertarian understanding of the state. And we skipped over it before, but the Protestant Reformation in Northern Europe was a big factor in the birth of classical liberalism. So naturally, countries which have adopted the principles of classical liberalism are generally in agreement with the teachings of Protestant Christianity. But Islam rejects all of it and commands its followers to make the state Muslim. And this comes to the West in two general forms. The first is obviously terrorism, which is revolutionary Islamism, akin to Marxist socialism. And the second is conservative Islamism, which, like Fabian socialism, is content to play the long game, arguing for gradual reform through democratic processes. Left libertarians seem to confuse the latter with assimilation. But just because Muslims understand liberal democracy and are content to live by its rules for the time being, doesn't mean they've adopted liberal democracy, or certainly doesn't mean that they're reforming Islam to fit it.
Yeah, there's always this argument that, oh, there's plenty of, like, nice Muslims, and I always say, yeah, there's plenty of communists who are, you know, nice people in person, doesn't mean their ideology is good.
Yeah, terrorists can be nice too.
And it's also the argument that libertarians use to explain why Muslims are behaving the way they are is because they're only that way because of mainly American foreign policy. But although I do concede that has made things probably worse, it's the main justification for their violence comes from the book where their religion comes from, the Quran.
Yeah, and not only that, but the main justification for American foreign policy has been the very libertarian arguments that that they're making in this exact context is, you know, this idea that we'll spread freedom everywhere and then they'll be free to be Muslim. Well, hang on a second, Islam doesn't agree with that. And so us spreading these libertarian ideas to these foreign countries has resulted in this Islamic blowback. And, you know, 9/11, what was 9/11 in response to? 9/11 was a political statement to awaken Muslims to this idea of you know, the reality of encroaching liberalism, and they've responded with encroaching Islam. And so we're all trying to impose our world on everybody else, right? And libertarians are just as guilty of that as anyone else. And so this idea that, oh, if we're all libertarian, well, then, you know, it'll all be fine. Well, hang on a second. If we're all libertarian, then no one's a Muslim. And if you're a Muslim, you're going to have a problem with that.
It's also, we've talked a lot about Islam, but we'll talk about whether border controls in general are justified under libertarian philosophy.
Yeah, well, in general, whenever you're importing a foreign culture, prudence is a virtue. There's some obvious cultures around the world, mostly within the Anglosphere, where unrestricted movement between countries could take place with very few issues. But there are also vastly different cultures in terms of education levels, affluence, morals, politics, and allegiances. Saying that if you open the door to some, we have to open the door to all is silly. I mean, treating a New Zealander the same as a Saudi is unfair to New Zealanders, and treating a Saudi the same as a New Zealander invites trouble. And it's perfectly fine to discriminate on any basis you like at the border. In fact, discriminating at the border is a really good way to avoid too much discrimination domestically. If we're only bringing in the people that are going to assimilate well or leave quickly, then it's a reasonable argument, a reasonable assumption by everyone already here that a foreigner is probably no threat. On the other hand, if border controls are too lax, then it becomes reasonable to treat foreigners as if they are a threat with no evidence either way. If you don't have to deal with them, then why would you take the risk, essentially? Plus, the only reason we're doing it, if the only reason we're doing it is to prove we're not racist, then that's both a really terrible reason and possibly quite wrong. I mean, the White Australia policy was only repealed 50 years ago. We certainly haven't evolved since then. And I think there's some fairly good evidence around to say that Australians are a bit racist. Importing foreigners doesn't cure that. It inflames it.
Yeah, I always say that part of the right of people living in a country or in a community is that they have the right to have a say in how their community looks. I mean, I often view a country as pretty much the same as a private club. I mean, private clubs are allowed to decide who is a member of that, and if they don't want certain people joining their club, then they don't ever accept them. We don't live in a complete private property society as obviously the anarcho-capitalists would like. And so we do have this public land. And how do we decide who's allowed to come onto this public land from other countries? It's by voting in democracies. And so people have the right through democracy to have a say about, you know, who they want to let in.
So that's similar, I suppose, to what Rothbard was talking about. In Nations by Consent. My view, I think, is perhaps a bit more Hayekian. It's that it's impossible to understand society completely, and that there is always going to be more than what meets the eye. And I think about people who are otherwise good people, but who have a short fuse when dealing with foreigners. Calling them ignorant or racist doesn't stop them being ignorant or racist. And if they're otherwise gainfully employed and productive members of society, then I don't see how it's on anyone to cure them of anything. I certainly don't think they're made better off by being cured of their racism. And I'm also recognizant of Hobbes's arguments that just because you want to trade with someone doesn't mean you want to live next to them. But libertarianism proposes that it's not your decision who your neighbour sells or rents his house to. That might be nice in theory, but it's factually incorrect. All that's saying to the average Joe is vote for us and we'll move someone you hate next door to you because stuff you. And if you don't have to be racist to vote against that. And since people can and are voting against that, it seems pretty clear to me that it is their decision. And libertarians just don't like it.
Yeah, it's often they say that, oh, you know, why should I have to consider what the plebs think? I mean, my ideas are correct. If other people shouldn't get a say in what is my ideal society.
Yeah, that's right. And at which point we've well and truly jumped off the libertarian train and we're now, you know, just as authoritarian as anyone else.
So obviously there's a lot of open borders people there. They're quite triggered by Trump's wall, but I think it's perfectly okay to have that as a control over who comes in.
Yeah, I think Trump's wall is a good idea, not necessarily because I don't think Mexicans would make good Americans, but because I recognize that it's America's choice, not Mexico's, who comes to America and the conditions upon which they arrive. I mean, Australia is an island, so we have no need for a wall, and we exploit the air-sea gap to control our border fairly effectively. And the people who have moved to this country, so the people that have moved to this country are here because we've allowed it. Far be it for me to begrudge America the same right.
Okay, so we've talked about a lot about the more controversial issues of libertarianism. Now let's talk about some of the economic and more philosophical questions about libertarianism. Now, a lot of the discussion is about the difference between things that government can do and things that they should do.
Yeah, and so this is more or less the Keynes-Hayek debate. Such as there was one, and that sort of led to Hicks and Schumpeter and ultimately Friedman, excuse me, as the intellectual standard bearers of American capitalism in the late 20th century. The broadly Keynesian idea, not that it has much if anything to do with Keynes himself, is that government can make some broad scientific claims about the economy at any one time, and that economic policy must always be adaptive to what is measured. Through the desire of economists to sort of justify their own profession, this has led to some pretty big claims about what the government can do, though it ignores a fair bit of discussion about what the government should do. And alcohol and cigarette taxes, for example, are built on a fairly robust economic theory, but very little scientific testing in the real world. The Hayekian counterpunch is that economics, in its quest to be seen as just as scientific as physics, has led economists to confuse what is measurable for what actually matters. So we cannot say for certain the reason smokers smoke. So manipulating prices is a policy with no guarantees, barring that it's undoubtedly going to have unforeseen consequences. The broader counter-argument is that if government operates only according to principles known to be successful, then the market will adapt to those principles in an orderly fashion. And this is actually much closer to what Keynes himself wrote when discussing genuine uncertainty. When we look at business investment and consumer spending in the economy, businesses will be willing to take more risks if they don't have to factor in sudden changes to government policy. Hayek, far from refuting these ideas, actually builds on them in his final book, The Fatal Conceit. That a society adhering to broad principles will succeed if those principles are sound, and fail if they're not sound, and that this is how the human race evolves over time to create better and better societies.
Yeah, and going, you've talked about Hayek there, but also Adam Smith, he talked about the three roles of government.
Yeah, so the three roles given by Smith were basically defense of the nation, law and order, and provision of public infrastructure. And this brings us back to a conversation. The broadly speaking, the principles of government, according to Smith, was if there is something that a private sector, that the private sector would not do, but it was necessary that it be done, then the argument could be made that it was just justified responsibility of government. The foremost example being the provision of the national defense. Adam Smith's arguments here are quite fascinating. He posits that while national defense in ages gone could be achieved by part-time militia, capitalism makes possible through the division of labor the job of the professional soldier. And professional soldiers would always be superior to militias, particularly in fights with gunpowder weapons where discipline is the paramount skill. I've always found that to be a fascinating theory by Smith, not only because his logic is quite sound, but because of how diametrically opposed it was to Washington's arguments for the Second Amendment. If there is any distinction between classical liberalism and left libertarianism, it is the competing views about standing armies. It also explains why conservatives across the Anglosphere are generally much more forgiving of defense spending than other types of government spending. In conservative view, national defense is something from which everyone benefits, making it necessary, but which few would pay for if they didn't have to. Quite a bit of libertarian thought has gone into refuting Smith's arguments for government. I've always found that ironic to the point of hypocrisy, since on the one hand libertarians point to the spectacular success of capitalism, and yet on the other argue against the theories of the man who kicked the whole thing off.
Yeah, I definitely agree that free markets can do a better job of delivering services and being more efficient than bureaucracies and governments, basically because of the profit motive and there's the incentives. Because basically the social democratic argument in favor of universal health care and compulsory education is that without these things, then there would be people who miss out. But the fact that companies, they're able to reduce the costs as much as possible, while the bureaucracies, the way that they see this success is increasing their budgets and expanding their operations. So you're basically having a, in a bureaucratic sense, you're having more cost bloat, which leads to poorer delivery and poorer services, which basically disadvantages the lower income people who you were trying to advantage in the first place.
Yeah, and it's not like bureaucrats don't have any incentives. It's that they have the wrong incentives.
Yes.
People tend to care more about their own property than the property of others. So, in general, private ownership of various things leads to better and more sustainable use of those things. Now, the argument that is now that argument is indeed pure Smith, but interestingly enough, he was making it not in opposition to government action, but in fact against the idea of a joint stock company. Or as we know today, the limited liability corporation. I mentioned earlier that the joint stock company was a product of Fabian socialism. Modern libertarian theory is more about the critique of politicians trying to get elected by taxing broadly, but then spending specifically, thus causing a small amount of pain to everyone, but a great deal of pleasure to a certain voting bloc. Bureaucrats, on the other hand, are incentivized to keep their jobs, and in order to do that, they seek to make themselves necessary. This harkens back to the Schumpeterian idea of crowding out good investment. An example would be the reason that we rely on government for healthcare is because the government has crowded out private solutions. And because of this, healthcare is more expensive than it needs to be.
And people also forget that, before we had the welfare state and these government programs, I mean, there weren't people, just left to fend for themselves. There was this huge civil society, voluntary organizations which helped people. I mean, they're a distant memory now, so people often forget them. And I think the other thing that people or those on the left have a hard time grappling with is that they can't give the corporations credit. It's just that profit is always a dirty word for them, and it's like, oh, we can't concede that somebody might be benefiting off an essential service. The weird thing about that is, though, they're more than happy for private supermarkets to feed people. But the main reason that free markets, not only are they superior in delivering services, but they also allow for the free markets allow for wealth to expand, economies to expand, more technology, better production techniques, and socialism just means because of those perverse incentives that it means that we're all poorer.
Yeah, I mean, John Kenneth Galbraith famously said that under capitalism, man exploits his fellow man. Under communism, it's the other way around. The libertarian perspective on this is largely built on the Austrian school. In general, it's the idea that private enterprise run at a profit is both more efficient and effective than government-run businesses. So replacing private businesses with government-run business makes us all worse off. The libertarian opposition to socialism points to countries like North Korea and Venezuela to say, look, that's what happens when the government starts running everything. You get perverse incentives, corruption and graft, and economic stagnation. This is probably why libertarianism tends to attract a lot of people with training in economics, because even non-libertarian economists, John Kenneth Galbraith being one of them, tend to wind up making libertarian arguments. Amartya Sen's another example. I doubt he'd ever call himself a libertarian. And he says that when you look at economic inequality in a bugbear of the left in developing countries, that it's only indicating that economic development is actually taking place, as some industries must develop first so that other industries can develop in their presence. For example, you can't have a software industry without a concrete industry. computers don't do very well in the rain. So in order to have a software industry, you have to have buildings to put computers in, which means whoever is producing concrete is going to get rich first before anyone else can get rich. Greg Bankiw is another example of an economist who I doubt anyone would, who I doubt would see themselves as libertarian, but makes a case in his widely used textbook that economists and politicians make face a trade-off between fairness and efficiency, and that in general, those who choose efficiency over fairness do a better job than those who choose the opposite.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely the case that, as we're seeing with Venezuela at the moment, I mean, they're a country that's basically starving now. The government is tyrannical. But the difficulty with free market economics is that this brings it back to Henry Hazlitt's Economics in One Lesson, of course, Frederick Bastiat's law that libertarian free market economics is counterintuitive to a lot of people. What you actually think is the case is actually wrong.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, all of that seems pretty reasonable to me. Is you know, there's going to be trade-offs in life, and you can't, you should choose the better one. Even if it means there's a sacrifice somewhere else. And if on the whole, the sacrifice of one, like it's a cost-benefit equation, is so if you're looking at capitalism versus socialism, you're not particularly enthused about either of them. And you do a cost-benefit equation where you say, well, you know, look, a capitalism's got these fairly reasonable costs, but these enormous benefits. Socialism's got, you know, fairly small costs, but doesn't have a whole lot of benefit either.
And people also seem to forget the fact that every resource is scarce, and so we've got to come up with an efficient way to ration everything carefully. And the most efficient way to ration what scarce resources we have on the planet is through the free market. So we all use resources efficiently. I mean, it's not the case. I mean, some socialists, they think that the problem is that we've got all these resources in society and it's just being hoarded by all the rich people and we just need to grab it off them.
Yeah, so rich people create poor people, but in fact, rich people create other rich people.
As socialism, there's a good saying about it that we can't all be rich, so let's be equally poor together. Now, we've talked about libertarian economics, but let's talk about the social policy aspects. So we talked about at the beginning that libertarianism is sold as being economically conservative and socially liberal, but I reckon this is quite incorrect because you don't have to be personally socially liberal to be a libertarian. You can be a social conservative and be a libertarian. You just don't think that it's better for society for the government to enforce morality.
Yeah, so the social libertarian stuff tends to be a conversation had by lawyers and lobbyists of a progressive bent. It's built on the general idea that as long as you're not hurting anyone else, you should be free to do whatever you want. As this relates to government, it's the idea that government should be strictly restrained from passing any laws that restrict private behaviour, except in cases where that behaviour harms others. This is captured by the non-aggression principle, which in broad terms is the idea that the only warranted use of force is defence against force. Everyone has the natural right to life, liberty, and property, which translates to a future, your life, a present, a liberty, and a property, which is your past. This encourages thinking about the difference between positive and negative rights. If a woman is a compulsive slut, for example, nobody has the right to stop her, but she does not have the right to then demand a potential husband accept her when she's done playing the field. Another good example is drug use. Everyone has the right to use drugs, but a drug user does not have the right to expect others to pay for them. A negative right is the right to be free from interference from others. A positive right is the right to interfere with others. Libertarianism is built in large part around the idea that only negative rights exist and that positive rights are actually a modern form of slavery. I'm not actually convinced by this. I'd say it's really so clean cut. A good example where libertarian social policy ties itself in knots is on the subject of abortion. On the one hand, the mother's right to choose what to do with her body is her liberty. On the other hand, a baby's right to life is exactly that. It's life. So you have a battle of negative rights. One way or the other, someone is aggressing against someone else. And when you start thinking thinking about the battle of negative rights, you start to realize that a lot of things that seem clear-cut according to libertarian thinking, but really aren't. If I find the use of certain drugs morally offensive, libertarianism says don't do drugs, which seems simple enough. But if I want to live in a community where nobody does drugs, libertarianism says you can't. You have to put up with the presence of drugs so as not to avoid infringing on the liberty of others. But at that point, it becomes a positive right for the drug user to exist in every community. You might argue that surely libertarians would admit that you have the right to manage your community a certain way, provided everyone agrees. But where does that end? Are we talking about my neighborhood, my town, my city, my state, my country, my planet? Take the Philippines, for example. President Duterte has basically made the killing of drug users legal, and tens of thousands have died as a result. Libertarians looking at that and saying he doesn't have the right to do that. But yet he's overwhelmingly popular with his people. What right do libertarians have to sanction him? And if they have no right to sanction him, then it seems to me that he does indeed have the right to kill drug users in his own country. And if we're going that far, how can we possibly say that socialism or fascism is wrong? The Nazis in Germany were elected. In fact, they were quite popular in Germany at the time. The German people decided they wanted to live in a country without Jews. If we are denying anyone any positive rights, then we must say that Jews do not have the right to live in Germany. So at which point libertarianism has become a justification for the Holocaust. So libertarianism has a lot to say about theory, but when that theory is applied, it seems to me that libertarianism is self-defeating. It has contributions to make to improving society and government, but a truly libertarian government is simply impossible. Inevitably, there will be exceptions and hypocrisies that are just simply impossible to solve without some other body of theory, more amenable to positive rights, stepping in to fill the gaps. And that's why I say liberty is impossible without nationalism, despite all the hooping and hollering of libertarians over the last 20 years in opposition to the ideas of Adam Smith. In actual fact, Adam Smith had a far more profound understanding of liberty than libertarians today. It is still, at the end of the day, defending the freedom of the nation that we are most concerned with. And it's not necessarily the freedom of those within it.
Yeah, you raise a lot of interesting points there. The way that I sell libertarianism to social conservatives is the fact that I always say that, you know, if you want, you know, a moral society, then prohibition is probably the worst way to do it, because you turn people who have, say, sex and drug problems into criminals, and that is not the best way to help them. It's much better to have a community-based response. So I really dislike the left libertarians who are like, hey, you know, you should be able to have sex wherever you want and use drugs wherever you want, and basically have that, you know, it's my right to things end of argument, which does not sell the message of liberty to anyone as well. Having said that, though, obviously, you know, we all have different morals and views on social issues, and for some people they might want to live in a community which is free of drugs and pornography or alternative sexual practices, and they should have the right to do that. But there also another place or community should have the right, if they want to have a permissive society, they should be able to have that as well. So that's where I really like the United States, with 50 states having their own moral laws if they want. So if one state wants to prohibit alcohol, that's their right. You can just move to another state where it's legal. If one state wants to outlaw sodomy, then if you want to practice it, just go to another state. But having said that, though, I still don't think that those communities should punish people for moral laws. I think the appropriate punishment should be banishment or exile. So therefore, they're kicked out, but they're free to go to somewhere where it's acceptable.
Yeah, there might be a case to be made there. Yeah, sure.
Now, the Liberal Democratic State, a lot of people view it as, a lot of libertarians view it as too much of a compromise, not radical enough. But it's argued that it's the ultimate bastion of freedom and defense against tyranny.
Yeah, and So this is kind of the point I'm making is we've got to concern ourselves a lot less with the march of freedom and human rights around the world. At the very least, we must restrict conversations of liberty to our liberty and respect that other countries might have a different way of doing things. That seems pretty simple at first glance, but it does propose some pretty significant policy changes. For a start, the foreign aid budget would be reduced to zero, and even privately funded NGOs would have to be restricted from political advocacy if they wish to operate in Australia. If we're saying to the world that we're going to be free regardless of what you do, and we're not going to tell you what to do, but you damn sure better not tell us what to do, then we can't have our people running around the world spreading liberty to countries that don't want it. If we're to be more libertarian in Australia, then we would not be able to tolerate foreign NGOs spreading socialism or fascism or Islam or any other competing ideology in Australia. Essentially, we would not tolerate intolerance for our way of life. This suggests a radical rethinking of the way we handle asylum seekers as well. As it stands, we take in refugees on the basis of unable to live in their own countries or fleeing persecution at the hands of their government. This is obviously built on the ideas of Jews fleeing persecution from Nazi Germany. It works when you can split up the world into two camps, liberalism and socialism. Unable to live under socialism means able to live under liberalism. But in a multipolar world of many different flavors of political beliefs, asylum seekers can only be accepted under a much stricter proviso of has accepted the principles of our way of life. Essentially, the only people we'd be letting in would be fans of Australia, even asking them that they've rejected their own heritage is not enough. They must accept ours. And even then, we've got to be careful about not facilitating failed policies overseas. Countries that have failed to develop because of poor political structures or have overpopulated because of poor social institutions, and as a consequence of producing economic refugees, are essentially outsourcing their problems to us. If they're unsustainable, then the faster they collapse, the better for everyone. We're not doing anyone any favours by importing the world's poor, least of all ourselves.
Obviously, the anarcho-capitalism or radical libertarians, they hate the nation state, but there is always going to be, whether there is an anarcho-capitalist society, there is always going to be some form of community rule or governance. And so I definitely think that the nation state, it is important to make sure, as we mentioned before, that people have a say in how their communities are run. And definitely the policies of a government or even right down to community level, it should be to look after the people living in those communities. It should not be to look after people who are miles and miles away. I mean, the perfect example is the fact that most people look after the welfare of their families first before anyone else. And I think that should be the same as a nation does. And definitely, if we all want to live together in disagreement, then we have to make sure that, you know, we stick to our own parts of the world. And also, yeah, I definitely agree that spreading our, you know, the virtues of, you know, Western democracies overseas is completely futile. I mean, this is what libertarians themselves are trying to do. They're trying to remake the world in their image, which is, the world is made up of people a lot of who don't agree with you. And so it's a complete waste of time and actually counterproductive to try and enforce your views and your way of living on other people. And we've seen that play out over the last two decades in the Middle East.
Yeah, well, certainly. I mean, if you look at the only argument for the war in Iraq that still holds water is we're going to spread freedom to Iraq. Well, we didn't. What we did was we caused the rise of ISIS, and the reason was because they didn't want freedom. What we call freedom. They didn't want anything to do with it. They wanted Islam, and they got it. Right. And so we're sort of sitting here, sort of saying, "Well, you can't have it." Well, of course, they can have it. I mean, you know, if you're going to expect our guys to sacrifice their lives for them and they don't even want it, well, that's just absurd, and it's never ending. Is you'll be throwing money at that problem for the rest of forever. So the idea, and that brings it back to this point of this anarcho-capitalist community. Well, the anarcho-capitalist community is going to exist in a certain geographic place in a certain certain time frame, and in that time it's going to be surrounded by non-libertarian societies. Those non-libertarian societies might be looking at the anarcho-capitalist land and resources and going, you know, we'd be better off if that stuff was in our hands, and all we've got to do is kill these clowns who won't even buy an army. So is at the end of the day, you're going to need a nation state. You need the nation state to be a bulwark against, you know, different tribes with different ideas about how they want to live their lives and all that sort of stuff. So if you want freedom to exist anywhere, it has to be within the broader context of a nation state.
You're definitely free to convince people overseas of the virtues of your ideas, but you definitely don't have the right to enforce it. And I often use the term libertarian dictatorship. You can't just say, this is my right to something, end of conversation, you just have to all accept it. I think libertarians are not winning any friends with that strategy.
No, well, yeah, is as I said earlier, is you know, the Ron Paul campaign attracted a lot of energetic thinkers, and they became extremists. They became, you know, they became obsessed with this utopian vision of libertopia. And yeah, at the end of the day, all you've done is just turned everyone off. So yeah, but you know, at the same time, there's not a real solution there. For libertarianism is you're either going to stick with your principles or you're not. If you're not going to stick with your principles, then, well, give up on libertarianism. And if you are going to stick with your principles, well, then you're going to lose. So there's no real solution there for libertarianism. It's just kind of doomed to this sort of slow, steady decline into nothingness.
Well, there's a whole bunch more of things about libertarianism we could talk about, but unfortunately we're out of time. So we didn't get a chance to discuss what should be the way forward for libertarianism, but maybe we'll save that for a future show. But that's the end of our first ever philosophy show. So thank you, Sam, for being the first co-host for this format.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, and so we hope you enjoyed this new show. We've got a whole list of topics for future episodes, so make sure you stay tuned for those. And of course, at the end of every episode, the usual reminders apply. Don't forget to sign up to our email list at theunshackled.net/subscribe. Don't forget, you can also support the work of The Unshackled, becoming a patron on Patreon, donate via PayPal, or sign up to be an advertiser with us. And of course, don't forget to subscribe to the show on SoundCloud, iTunes, Stitcher, TuneIn Radio, or view the video version on YouTube. And of course, don't forget to keep checking out theunshackled.net for all the latest news. So thanks once again for listening, and we'll see you next time.